जबकि उत्तराखंडी टोपी पहनी है,
जी
बहुत
जी
आपको बहुत शोभा देती है बाकी। शेखर जी, आपका चेहरा दिखते ही हम शुरू करते हैं।
अभी बिजी जा रहा है शेखर जी का नंबर।
अच्छा, आपने बात तो कर दी ना। हाँ जी, हाँ जी, ठीक है, ओके, सुन रहे हैं। अच्छा, उनकी आवाज भी नहीं आ रही है। हाँ क्या करें, शुरू कर दें। शेखर जी, आप कुछ कहिए, आप अपने
म्यूट
आप को अनम्यूट करके।
म्यूट वहां नेटवर्क की बहुत समस्या रहती है शेखर जी के इलाके में।
अच्छा, अगर उनको सुनाई भी दे रहा हो तो हम शुरू करते हैं और फिर हम उनसे कुछ शब्द भी सुनना चाहेंगे।
जी, वहां से दरअसल अगर शेखर जी तक बात पहुंच रही हो तो सर वीडियो में बाइट्स ज्यादा लगते हैं, तो अगर आप ऑडियो ही ऑन कर दें तो आप ऑडियो के जरिए भी जुड़ते हैं कार्यक्रम से। जी
जी, चलिए हम शुरू करते हैं, क्योंकि हमारा दूसरा भी आज प्रेजेंटेशन है, बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट प्रेजेंटेशन है हितेंद्र पटेल जी का, तो हम उसका भी इंतजार कर रहे हैं। तो हम पहले इसका इससे शुरुआत करते हैं। तो साथियों, मुझे बहुत आज खुशी हो रही है कि एक बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण किताब जिसका शीर्षक है हरी भरी उम्मीद, इसका हम विमोचन करने जा रहे हैं। एक ही प्रति आई है, तो पहले हम क्यों नहीं फोटो इसका ले लेते हैं। आइए आइए।
जी
अच्छा, तो प्लीज आप सबको एक एक कॉपी दे के ना। हाँ, ये अच्छा रहेगा, पहले इसका हम विमोचन करते हैं। दे दीजिए, दे दीजिए, सबको दे दीजिए, एक पटेल साहब को दीजिए और एक मुझे दीजिए। धन्यवाद। पहले हम इससे शुरुआत करते हैं। फोटो तो यहाँ आएगा, मुझे लगता है आप लोग यहाँ आ जाइए, पास में होगा, चलेगा। थोड़ा
हाँ नहीं तो ये
सही
नहीं।
करना, साथ साथ
आप आए सर,
तो साथ आप आइए, साथ भी आइए,
पीछे
आप भी आइए।
पीछे जोरदार तालियों के साथ किताब का स्वागत।
कहना चाहूंगा थोड़ी साहब से भी, यहाँ निवेदन करूंगा कुछ तो चीजें कहें। ये लीजिए, एक किताब है, तो इसमें इनको तो चीजें हैं मेरे हिसाब से बहुत ही गौरतलब है। एक तो शेखर पाठक जी, ही इज अ लेजेंड इन उत्तराखंड, एम आई राइट,
यस
एंड मे बी ऑल ओवर इंडिया,
बिल्कुल
एंड ही इज हैज बीन ए फेलो ऑफ आई many many years ago here, and I had met him several times in Delhi. He also used to conduct these trips to Kailash, you know, and he's a so what I wanted to say is that there are many different kinds of histories. We're going to talk about some of them later, novels in the form of histories, but I think this book is very important because Shekhar ji has himself been a part of this history which he's documented, the history of Chitkos. And it's also very important for us because Atithi ji is here with us, and हमारा जो वाणी प्रकाशन के साथ हमारी जो पार्टनरशिप है, इसको हम बढ़ावा देने जा रहे हैं। हमारे पास उसकी कॉन्ट्रैक्ट आ चुकी है, तो चेतना और हिमांजलि दोनों वाणी से हम अभी छापित करेंगे और प्रकाशित भी करेंगे। तो मुझे लगता है कि इससे मतलब उसकी सर्कुलेशन बहुत ज्यादा बढ़ जाएगी, और पहले तो हमारे तक ये सीमित था, लेकिन हम चाहते हैं दोनों पत्रिकाएं बहुत आगे जाए, है ना। तो थैंक यू सो मच आदित्य जी, वी लुक फॉरवर्ड टू मोर कोलैबोरेशंस विथ यू, एंड दिस बुक हैज आल्सो बीन पब्लिश्ड बाय वाणी प्रकाशन। इट्स अ वेरी सब्सटेंशियल बुक, अगर आप देखें तो 500 से अधिक इसमें पृष्ठ हैं, और इनफैक्ट 600 के करीब है। एंड मैं थोड़ी सी इसकी अनुक्रमणिका पढ़ रहा था और कुछ चैप्टर्स भी मैंने पढ़े. इट्स अ वेरी डिटेल्ड, आई थिंक इट्स द बेस्ट हिस्ट्री सो फार ऑफ द चिपको मूवमेंट. एंड आई थिंक प्रोफेसर पुरोहित, इवन प्रोफेसर पटेल मे वॉन्ट टू से फ्यू वर्ड्स अबाउट इट, बट आई जस्ट वॉन्टेड टू सी टू थिंग्स. मैं जब IIT में पढ़ाता था फ्रॉम 1994 टू 1999, हम लोग भी किसी तरह सोशल मूवमेंट से जुड़ गए थे. एंड आई गॉट टू मीट अ नंबर ऑफ पीपल यू नो हु वर इन आवर सोशल मूवमेंट्स, फिशरमैन मूवमेंट्स, नर्मदा बचाव मूवमेंट्स, चिपको एंड मेनी अदर मूवमेंट्स. एंड आई मस्ट कन्फेस, मैं ज्यादा एक्टिविस्ट नहीं हूँ, बिकॉज आई फाउंड इन JNU क्या होता है, मैं बताऊँ आपको, या तो आप एक्टिविस्ट बन सकते हैं या तो आप एकेडमिक बन सकते हैं. आप दोनों बनने की कोशिश करेंगे, इट्स लाइक फॉलिंग बिटवीन टू स्टूल्स. ना तो आप एकेडमिक अच्छा बन पाएंगे ना एक्टिविस्ट अच्छा बन पाएंगे. तो वो मुझे बहुत पहले समझ में आ गया था कि हम दूर से चीजों को समर्थन कर सकते हैं, अपना लेखन ही अपना एक्टिविज्म होता है. दरअसल हम लोग जो है बुद्धिजीवी हैं, अब हम आंदोलन में घुस जाएंगे तो एक चीज तो छूट जाएगी. खैर, लेकिन दोज वर अर्ली डेज, वी हैड फाउंड अ ग्रुप देयर IIT में कॉल्ड स्वराज स्टडी सर्कल, जिसका संयोजक मैं था. तो आई वॉज वेरी इंस्पायर्ड बाय सम ऑफ दीज पीपल, आई मस्ट टेल यू. एंड विद सुंदरलाल बहुगुणा जी, उनका एक आश्रम था टेढ़ी में, बिलंगना जो नदी है उसके एग्जैक्टली. तो यू वोंट बिलीव इट सर, मैं वहां गया था उनको मिलने, और डूब क्षेत्र के बिल्कुल भीतर उन्होंने अपनी कुटी बना ली थी. उस कुटी में मैंने जाके उनके दर्शन भी किए, और कोर्ट से भी कुछ मदद नहीं आई थी, तो एक पूरा दिन मैंने उनके साथ बिताया. तो तब उन्होंने मुझे कहा, मैंने उनसे कहा, सर यहाँ ये तो डूब क्षेत्र है, ऊपर टेढ़ी, न्यू टेढ़ी ऊपर है, ये सब पानी के नीचे आ जाएगा, क्या करेंगे? तो उन्होंने कहा हम भी डूब जाएंगे उसके साथ. आई वाज सो शॉक्ड, हालांकि वो हुआ नहीं था एक्चुअली, बट अ वेरी सिंपल कुटिया थी. मिसेस बहुगुणा वाज आल्सो देयर, एंड इट वाज अ ब्यूटीफुल मोमेंट फॉर मी. जब मैं उसकी याद करता हूँ, वेरी इंस्पायरिंग मोमेंट. And Sundarlal ji was a very simple person. Then I met, of course, Chandi Prasad Bhatt ji. I met a number of those people. And I still remember one interesting thing he said, Prithiji. Sundarlal ji said, ye to JP wale hi bana rahe hain. Aap log hi unke share khareedte hain. Mujhe unhone kaha, aap hi khareedenge sir. Maine kaha, sir, main JP ke share kabhi nahi khareedunga. And I must say, I've kept up to that. So I've never, of course, ab to company ekdam kharab ho gayi. बट बहुत उछल रही थी उस समय. तो दैट वन लिटिल बिट आई स्टिल रिमेंबर. एनीहाउ, आई नाउ इनवाइट, सो कांग्रेचुलेशंस शेखर जी फॉर लिसनिंग टू मी. बहुत बहुत बधाई हो, और ऐसे ही आप खूब लिखते रहें, और हम सब लोगों की तरफ से आपको
अच्छा अच्छा आप भी कुछ कहना चाहेंगे. ठीक है, ठीक है. तो आप पहले कुछ कहिए सर, फिर हम दूसरी चीज की शुरुआत करते हैं.
आई आई प्लीज. और आपके बाद भी आस्क अदिति जी जो से सब
ओके, आई विल बी वेरी ब्रीफ. सभी आदरणीयों को प्रणाम करते हुए मैं इस पुस्तक के लेखक प्रोफेसर शेखर पाठक को बधाई और साधुवाद देता हूँ कि आपने उस पूरे इतिहास को, जिसको हम बचपन से जीते आए हैं, पुस्तक का रूप दे दिया. बड़ा अच्छा लग रहा है. इसके टाइटल पर से आइडिया आ जा रहा है क्या क्या है. शेखर पाठक जी चिपको आंदोलन के शुरू के दौर से ही उससे जुड़ गए थे, और मुझे याद है कि कई बार उन्होंने गोपेश्वर में आके चिपको आंदोलन के कई रोड शोज भी किए थे. और एक बहुत ही प्रसिद्ध घटना जो नैनीताल में जंगलात के ठेके में इन लोगों ने प्रदर्शन किया था, किसी ने ऑफिस में आग लगा दी थी, इनमें से बहुत सारे लोग बंद हो गए थे. शमशेर सिंह बिष्ट, शेखर पाठक, राजीव लोचन शाह, बहुत सारे लोग. और ये जो चिपको आंदोलन था, इसकी भूमिका जैसे कि आपने बताया कि ये असल में वनों पे अधिकार के लिए शुरू हुई थी, कि पहाड़ के लोगों को एक छोटी सी वो जुआ होता है, बैलों के कंधे में रखने वाला जुआ, उसके लिए भी लकड़ी नहीं मिलती थी. जबकि एक बैट्स बनाने वाली बरेली की कंपनी, मैं भूल रहा हूँ उसका नाम इस समय, उसको लाखों की लकड़ी मिली। तो ये आंदोलन वहां से शुरू, उस अधिकार के लिए शुरू होके बाद में ये आया कि अगर इस तरह से वन कटते रहे तो पूरा पहाड़ी खाली हो जाए, और ये बढ़ते बढ़ते उसका आंदोलन केदार घाटी से आंदोलन शुरू होके फिर बाद में रीणी घाटी में आंदोलन चला, और इस आंदोलन के जो कर्णधार थे चंडी प्रसाद भट्ट जी, सुंदरलाल बहुगुणा जी, चिरंजी लाल जी, आलम सिंह बिष्ट जी और गोविंद सिंह राव जी, लाता गांव की महिलाएं, रेणी गांव की महिलाएं, मैं ये बातें इसलिए बता रहा हूँ कि प्रोफेसर शेखर पाठक भी इसको सुन रहे हैं, इस किताब में इसको पढ़ेंगे। ये आंदोलन बड़ा लंबा चला और एक दिन संयोग से मैं भी इसका हिस्सा बन गया। मैं उस समय बीए में पढ़ता था, तो वहां से लोगों ने कहा चलो जी रेणी चलना, जोशीमठ बस में बैठ के सब लोग चलो, वहां आंदोलन हो रहा है, उनको सपोर्ट करना। तो हम लोग को कुछ पता था नहीं, हमको तो खाली घूमने का शौक था। वहां पे गए तो बड़ी गहमा गहमी हो रही थी, क्या होगा क्या होगा। तभी खबर आई ऊपर से कि जो ठेकेदार जंगल काटने आए थे वो वहां से भाग गए। कैसे भाग गए? औरतों ने उन्हें चैलेंज किया कि अगर तुम पेड़ काटोगे, उससे हम चिपक गए हैं पेड़ पे, हमको काटो। तो ये आंदोलन कई गांव से हो गया था, लेकिन यहाँ पे फिर लोगों ने कहा कि इस आंदोलन को क्या कहा जाए, क्या कहा जाए। एक वहां पे हमारे मित्र थे ओम प्रकाश चमोली जी, श्रीनगर पॉलिटेक्निक में पढ़ते थे, उन्होंने कहा यार इसको चिपको ही कहा जाए। कहा यार ठीक नाम है, चिपको कहा जाए इसको। तो आंदोलन तो पहले से था, भट्ट जी और सुंदरलाल बहुगुणा जी इसको चला रहे थे, लेकिन वहां पे इसको नाम मिल गया चिपको। और सौभाग्य से जब मैं अपने मुखौटों पे रिसर्च कर रहा था, इस आंदोलन की जो अग्रणी थी गौरा देवी, उनको मैं, उनका मायका था, जिस मायके में मुखौटों का वो निष्पादन हो रहा था उसमें मैं था, तो मैंने बाकायदा एक घंटे का उनका इंटरव्यू भी लिया कि आखिर हुआ क्या था। तो उन्होंने बताया जो भी हुआ, एक एक ये बहुत बड़ा आंदोलन उसके बाद चला, और पहाड़ में एक जमाना वो था कि जो नदियां होती थी, नदियों का पानी नहीं दिखता था। जो जंगल कटे थे, जो विल्सन ने एक मशीन निकाली गरारी, वो लकड़ियों की एक नाली जैसे बनाता था, और कहां कहां से उस नाली में लकड़ियां फिसला करके नदी में ले आते, और वहां से ट्रांसपोर्ट होता था, और नदी में सीजन भी होती थी लकड़ियां, और फ्री का ट्रांसपोर्ट भी होता था। तो पूरे का पूरा नदी का जो ऊपर की सतह है वो लकड़ियों से पटी रहती थी। कितनी कितने जंगल कटे होंगे उस जमाने में, मुझे याद है कि श्रीनगर जैसी चौड़ी जगह पे, आपने तो देखी है, हम लोग उन लकड़ियों को पकड़ पकड़, मैं तो नहीं मेरे साथी, उनको पकड़ पकड़ के नदी पार कर देते थे। तो ये बहुत बड़ा दोहन चल रहा था, और चिपको का सबसे बड़ा जो असर हुआ, इंडियन फॉरेस्ट एक्ट 1980 आया, और उसके बाद एक ब्लैंकेट बैन जंगलों के काटने में लग गया। उसके भी बहुत सारे इम्प्लीकेशंस आए लोगों के अधिकारों और उनसे जुड़े हुए। लेकिन प्रोफेसर शेखर पाठक एक ऐसे व्यक्ति हैं जिन्होंने दुनिया के लगभग हर पहाड़ को नापा है, और उत्तराखंड को न केवल, ये तो इनकी किताब एनवायरनमेंट पे है, इन्होंने 100 से अधिक पुस्तकें उत्तराखंड के साहित्य, समाज, इतिहास, संगीत, कोई ऐसी चीज नहीं है जिसको, जो उनको मिला उन्होंने छापी है। हर महत्वपूर्ण पुस्तक उन्होंने अपने पहाड़ प्रकाशन के माध्यम से छापी है, और हमारे तो लेजेंड से भी बड़े हैं। मैंने सर को कल कहा था कि वो शीर्ष पुरुष हैं उत्तराखंड। कोई भी बात, किसी इतिहास की बात हो, कोई निर्णय की बात हो, कोई ओपिनियन की बात हो, तो शेखर पाठक से ऊपर कोई भी नहीं। मैं इतना ही कहना चाहता हूं, और आप सब लोगों को बधाई देता हूं कि इस संस्थान और वाणी प्रकाशन ने मिलकर ये पुस्तक छापी है, और ऐसी महत्वपूर्ण पुस्तकें छपती रहें। धन्यवाद।
अब मैं अदिति जी से
जी।
उनका माइक चल रहा हो शेखर जी का, तो फिर हम उनको भी आमंत्रण करना चाहते हैं कि आप भी कुछ हमें दो शब्द से संबोधित करें। अदिति जी आप
जी। धन्यवाद सर। IIAS का बहुत आभार कि इतनी महत्वपूर्ण रिसर्च के लिए वाणी प्रकाशन को प्रकाशन सह प्रकाशन योजना में साथ जोड़कर हमें ये सौभाग्य दिया कि हम ये हरी भरी उम्मीद जो कि जंगलात से जुड़े सारे आंदोलनों का एक बृहद इतिहास है आपके सामने पूरी दुनिया के सामने प्रस्तुत कर सकें। शेखर जी के साथ उनको उनको तो कौन नहीं जानता, सब मुझसे पहले दो पीढ़ी के लोग शेखर जी को पढ़कर बड़े हुए हैं, उन्हें समझते भी बड़े हुए हैं, लेकिन फिर भी क्योंकि मैं इस किताब की संपादक और प्रकाशक हूँ तो मुझे कुछ कहना है। वो ये कि तेहरी पिथौरागढ़ और अल्मोड़ा में छात्र आंदोलन 70 के दशक में बहुत प्रगाढ़ रूप से आगे बढ़ रहे थे, बहुत ही पॉजिटिव छात्र आंदोलन थे। उन आज जो एग्रेसिव चेहरा छात्र आंदोलनों का आक्रामक चेहरा हमारे सामने है, उस दशक के छात्र आंदोलन इस प्रकार के थे। वो समाज से और भारतीय जड़ों से जूझने की, उनको समझने की, उनसे पूरी दुनिया का परिचय कराने की जद्दोजहद में जुड़े हुए थे। ऐसे छात्र आंदोलन में हमारे शेखर जी 70 के दशक में सिर्फ ना उनसे उनका वास्ता था बल्कि उसे ऑर्गेनाइज करने में भी उनकी बहुत बड़ी भूमिका। 1976 में पिथौरी ग्लेशियर को देखने की इन्होंने यात्रा की, सबसे पहली यात्रा थी, और उसके बाद जो इन्होंने एक पत्रिका प्रकाशन किया शक्ति पत्रिका में, जो वहां की लोकल पत्रिका थी, उसके बाद सुंदरलाल बहुगुणा शेखर जी से संपर्क किया और उन्होंने जाना कि ये एक मेधावी छात्र है जो बहुत कुछ करना चाहता है एथनोग्राफी को लेकर, इतिहास को लेकर, पर्यावरण को लेकर। तो 1974 में पहली अस्कोट अराकोट यात्रा शेखर जी ने की, जो कि दशक में एक बार होती है, और इस यात्रा में न सिर्फ जंगल पर्यावरण से संबंधित जानकारी इकट्ठी की जाती है बल्कि एक बहुत बड़ी एथनोग्राफी है जिसमें पैरेलल इकोनॉमी जंगलों से किस तरह से बढ़ रही है, किस तरह से अपना संबंध स्थापित कर रही है बाकी दुनिया से, उसकी भी स्टडी की जाती है। तो अस्कोट अराकोट यात्रा शेखर जी आज तक 5 यात्राएं कर चुके हैं। ये काफी कठिन होती है और काफी प्रतिबद्धता मांगती है, और शेखर जी तो प्रतिबद्धता के पर्याय हैं, तो उन्होंने आज 5 यात्राओं का समग्र हमारे सामने प्रस्तुत किया है। 3 दशक पहले कुमाऊं यूनिवर्सिटी में इतिहास पढ़ाते थे, आज IIAS स्कॉलर हैं, नेहरू मेमोरियल लाइब्रेरी स्कॉलर हैं, महापंडित राहुल सांकृत्या पुरस्कार से पुरस्कृत सुसज्जित हैं, और पीपल्स लिंग्विस्टिक सर्वे के कोर कमिटी मेंबर हैं, और मुझे लगता है कि हरी भरी उम्मीद का प्रकाशन IIAS के तत्वावधान वाणी प्रकाशन के साथ ही हो पाना मुमकिन था, क्योंकि एक इतना बड़ा कार्य है, 5 दशक की मेहनत एक व्यक्ति की, तो संस्थागत रूप से ही व्यवस्थित हो सकती थी। बहुत शुक्रिया कि हमें सपोर्ट IIAS से हमेशा मिलता रहा है, जैसे कि सर ने अभी बताया कि आने वाले समय में हिमांचलि, चेतना और भी महत्वपूर्ण प्रकाशन हिंदी में हम IIAS के साथ आप सबसे साझा करते रहेंगे। और आज इस कार्यक्रम में आप सब जुड़े हैं, माधव हाड़ा जी और प्रेमचंद को मेरा आभार कि उन्होंने मुझे इस पूरे टेक्नोलॉजी के साथ में सामंजस्य बिठाने में मदद की, और सर का बहुत धन्यवाद कि आपने समय निकाला अपने स्कूल में से इस किताब के लिए, बहुत धन्यवाद।
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद अदिति जी। शेखर जी क्या हमसे जुड़ पाएंगे?
मैं एक बार फिर से फोन ट्राई करती हूँ शेखर जी।
कोशिश कीजिए। मैं
या ऐसा कर सकती हूँ कि शेखर जी से मैं फोन पे बात फोन स्पीकर पे डाल देती हूँ और मेरा वीडियो स्पीकर पे है, तो शेखर जी की आवाज
नहीं करते हम यही उनसे स्पीकर फोन पे करते हैं, नहीं तो
ओके
फिर सबको। हाँ, ये मैं ये कहना चाह रहा था, जब मैंने शुरुआत की तब मैंने कहा था कि एक्टिविस्ट और
एकेडमिक साथ नहीं हो सकते। मैं ये कहना चाह रहा था कि शेखर
दादा शेखर पाठक जी से एक्सेप्शन, ये मैं कहना चाह रहा था, वो मैं यहीं पे
हाँ पूरा सुन रहे जरा जरा सर से
स्पीकर
प्रोफेसर
हाँ
परांजपे से बात करिए फिर सबको बात।
स्पीकर फोन पे लगा दीजिए। हाँ
इसको
हाँ खोल दीजिए। शेखर जी प्रणाम, सुनाई दे रहा है? अच्छा, हम आपको स्पीकर फोन पे डाले हैं, आप कुछ कहेंगे? लाउड कर दीजिए।
अच्छा
नहीं, हमें तो सुनाई दे रही है लेकिन बहुत कम आवाज आ रही है। हेलो,
सॉरी।
जी 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 बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद शेखर जी। हम उम्मीद करेंगे कि आप इसी विषय पर एक हमें विशेष है ना लेक्चर से या हम कह सकते हैं हाँ करोना के बाद आप वेबिनार के जरिए अगर आपको अच्छी कनेक्शन मिल जाए तो हम उसका आयोजन कर सकते हैं। जी 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 आइए अवश्य आइए आपकी का घर है। अच्छा अच्छा शेखर जी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। आपको अगर फुर्सत हो तो आप हमसे जुड़े रहिए क्योंकि इसके बाद हमारा बहुत अच्छा एक सेमिनार होने जा रहा है जो हितेंद्र पटेल जी देने वाले हैं। तो मैं अभी आपसे आगे लेता हूँ। अच्छा अच्छा धन्यवाद बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद जी जी नमस्ते नमस्ते। So thank you friends, that went very well. Thank you Aditi ji, thank you Shekhar ji. And we will now move straight into our fellow's presentation this afternoon. I invite Dr. Yadav to please take the chair, Dr. Abhishek Yadav ji and Professor Hitendra Patel. चूंकि आपका पूरा इसका जो सारांश हिंदी में है कुछ अंग्रेजी में इसके बारे में बोलना चाहता हूँ। ये विषय बहुत ही दिलचस्प है खास करके मेरे लिए क्योंकि मैं एक साहित्य का छात्र रहा हूँ और व्हाट प्रोफेसर पटेल हैज बीन ट्राइंग टू डू वी ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड फ्रॉम द टाइम वी मेट हिम इन डिफेंस कॉलोनी ड्यूरिंग द इंटरव्यू प्रोसेस टिल टुडे इज टू सी इफ सम मेजर नॉवेल्स ड्यूरिंग द इंडिपेंडेंस पीरियड रिटन इन हिंदी कैन शेड सम new light on the independence movement. This is his project as I understand it. And he calls it, how do the novels inflect history? Ye inki terminology rahi hai yahan pe. And he looks at the three major ideological formations of that period. One is what he calls the composite nationalism that was led by Gandhi Nehru. In fact, I'll have a footnote on this because Gandhi Nehru Kaleen shabd ka prayog karte hain. पीरियडाइजेशन हम सब जानते हैं हिंदी साहित्य का एक बहुत क्या कहते हैं विवादास्पद बात रही है हम पीरियडाइज कैसे करें। अंग्रेजी साहित्य में भी आसान नहीं है वो तो किंग एंड क्वीन से करते हैं एलिजाबेथन जैकोबियन विक्टोरियन ऐसे एडवर्डियन ऐसे चल रहा था। इफ यू आर नॉट अ रॉयलिस्ट देन यू विल आस्क व्हाई आर यू यूजिंग यू नो द नेम्स ऑफ द किंग्स एंड क्वींस। सो हिंदी में भी ये बहुचर्चित एक मामला है आप पीरियडाइजेशन कैसे करेंगे
क्या आप उसी क्रम में जाते जाते मोदी
काल कहेंगे कि नहीं कहेंगे?
ये मतलब ये मेरे मन में एक शंका है, लेकिन ये माइनर चीज है। आप उसको पीरियडाइज कैसे करें, संज्ञा कैसे थी वो बात, लेकिन महत्वपूर्ण बात ये है कि ये तीन आइडियोलॉजिकल फॉर्मेशंस की बात यहाँ हो रही है, द कंपोजिट नेशनलिज्म ऑफ गांधी नेहरू, देन द राइट विंग हिंदू राष्ट्र हिंदुत्व नेशनलिज्म, एंड देन द लेफ्ट सोशलिस्ट एंड उसके भी जो लेफ्ट के नेशनलिज्म हैं। और इन्होंने तीन चार बहुत महत्वपूर्ण नॉवेलिस्ट को देखा, गुरुदत्त जो दक्षिणपंथी कहलाते हैं यहाँ पे, यशपाल जैसे सेंट्रिस्ट हैं, और फिर उस साइड में अगर आप देखें तो अमृतलाल नागर एक नाम आता है, भगवती चरण
वर्मा
वर्मा जी का नाम आता है। तो इस तरह इन्होंने ये इसकी रचना की है। अब मैं दो तीन चीजें कहना चाहूंगा, फिर आई विल हैंड इट ओवर। आप सबको याद होगा साथियों के जब पिछला प्रेजेंटेशन हुआ था तब मुझे इसके बाद भी जाना पड़ रहा है, लेकिन शुरुआत में मेरे निकलने के पहले पटेल साहब ने बहुत अच्छी दिलचस्प चीज की, उसमें कुछ व्यंग भी था। उन्होंने कहा मतलब कैसा जमाना है कि इतिहासक को छोड़ के हर एक आदमी इतिहास में बोल रहा। तो मैं भी यही कहूंगा, क्या अजीब जमाना है कि साहित्य को छोड़ के हर एक साहित्य भी बोल रहा है, चाहे वो पॉलिटिकल साइंटिस्ट क्यों ना हो, जैसे मेरे दोस्त सुदीप्त तो कविराज है कोलंबिया के, या ग्रेट पार्थ चटर्जी क्यों ना हो, या कोई हिस्टोरियन क्यों ना हो जैसे दीपेश चक्रवर्ती जी है, या हमारे ही सहकर्मी रहे हैं JNU में बहुत ही मशहूर हिस्टोरियन तनिका सरकार, शी राइट्स अबाउट लिटरेचर, देन प्रदीप दत्ता जी राइट्स अबाउट लिटरेचर, घरे बायरे के बारे में इन्होंने लिखा है। तो उसी क्रम में हमारे मित्र जितेंद्र जी भी लिख रहे हैं, लेकिन इसमें साहित्य के बारे में कुछ नहीं है, इस एब्स्ट्रैक्ट में एक शब्द भी नहीं है। तो दिस इज मेरे लिए ये चिंता का विषय है, आपने साहित्य को महज एक सोर्स समझा है हिस्ट्री का। साहित्य की अपनी दुनिया है, कि मैं कहूंगा कविता की एक अपना, उसकी मैं कहना चाहूंगा इट इज एन एपिस्टेमोलॉजी इन इट्स ओन राइट। तो साहित्य के कुछ तत्व हैं भरतनाट्य शास्त्र से आज तक, और अभिनव गुप्त तो कहते हैं कि वो तो अलौकिक है, लौकिक है ही नहीं। दैट इज व्हाट ही सेज, इफ यू रीड ध्वन्यालोक का, ही सेज साहित्य इज अलौकिक। तो इधर सिर्फ लौकिक भी ही नहीं, उसको ऐतिहासिक रूप से लिया गया है, और सब जो राइटर्स हैं उनमें से एक मुझे वाक्य भी नजर नहीं आ रहा, एक उदाहरण भी नहीं है। हालांकि ये एब्स्ट्रैक्ट है, मैं मानता हूँ मेन टेक्स्ट में तो बहुत आपने कोट किया होगा राइटर्स को, लेकिन मेन चीज यहाँ पे जो एंग्जाइटी मुझे दिख रही है इज टू हाउ टू फॉर्म्युलेट द प्रोजेक्ट, विच बाय द वे अप्रिशिएट, इट्स अ वेरी वेल फॉर्म्युलेटेड प्रोजेक्ट सर, I congratulate you on that. But I am deeply interested in seeing the literary examples and how these writers illustrate these broad views or broad ideological formations of nationalism. I would like to see more examples, but somewhere, literature is distinguished by a special kind of language, the use of words in a special way. So it is not, in other words, the question I want to raise is, can literature be reduced to history or sociology or political science? That is for me, ek meri wo chinta hai. And I hope that even as you continue on this project, and I wish it a grand success, somewhere you will deal with this issue, that I do not want to reduce or take away the special quality that is literature. But as a historian, my project is to see what literature can contribute to history. It's not to reduce the salience of literature, because literature cannot actually be appropriated or reduced to any other, should I say, form of knowledge, and not just, I mean, from Plato, that's why Plato said, poets should not be in the Republic. He said, poets are very dangerous, they should not be in the Republic. But having said that, I do believe if you look at Bhalchandra Bidyari's classification of the Indian novel, which is based on some, I think, models from Western criticism also, he identifies three kinds of novelists, not realism and reality, what Meenakshi Mukherjee does. He says there is a kind of novel which is what he calls pratikriti, that is, it escapes from reality, runs away from reality. You know, it's a romance or it's a historical fiction. It has very little to do with contemporary reality. Bankim challenged that because when Bankim writes Durgesh Nandini, it has something to do with contemporary reality. Okay, it's not an escape merely. But anyhow, that's Nemade's formulation. The other is Riti, that is the novel that is so deeply formalistic. Its passion is form. How beautifully can you organize words to create a structure, you know, like an hourglass maybe, you know, like in Ian Foster's Aspects of a Novel, he talks about that. And he says Henry James is a great example of rhythm and form and patterning, how a novel can be patterned, you know. And then he says there's this final kind of novel which is really, really important, which he calls the Kriti. So this genre, this type of novel engages directly with society, can intervene and change society even. And I think that the novelists you have chosen, sir, are those which believed in the capacity of the novel to engage with society and also change society. With these words, I invite you to make your presentation. And of course, Abhishekji will say a few words.
Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
तो सर हितेन पटेल के इस महत्वपूर्ण शोध परियोजना पर अपना दृष्टिकोण देने के लिए डॉक्टर पदांजपे का बहुत शुक्रिया। सबसे पहले तो मैं शेखर पाठक जी को बधाई दूं उनकी इस महत्वपूर्ण किताब के लिए, और उन्होंने बहुत अच्छा लिखा है और एक्टिविज्म भी बहुत अच्छा किया है। ऐसे बहुत सारे लोग हैं जो बहुत अच्छा लिख रहे हैं और काम कर रहे हैं। प्रोफेसर हितेन पटेल के प्रोजेक्ट के बारे में मैं वही कहेंगे, मैं दो बातें बहुत छोटी छोटी कहना चाहता हूँ। एक तो ये है कि साहित्य जो है वो लोगों के जीवन को एक तरह से दर्ज करता है, उनका अकाउंट है, और बहुत सारे ऐसे समाज हैं जिनका इतिहास नहीं लिखा गया या हमारे पास उनका कोई लिखित तौर पर प्राप्त नहीं है कोई इतिहास। तो ऐसे समाजों में साहित्य की बहुत बड़ी भूमिका है उनके इतिहास को देखने के लिए, इतिहास को समझने के लिए, और जीवन का अकाउंट है। इसीलिए बहुत सारी ऐसी चीजें जो इतिहास में नहीं लिखी जाती हैं, मैं एक किताब, साहित्यिक किताब का जिक्र करूंगा। ऐसे दोलजी थोंगची एक असमिया के बहुत प्रसिद्ध उपन्यासकार हैं, साहित्य अकादमी से सम्मानित हैं। उनका एक उपन्यास है मौन होठ मुखर हृदय, उसी किताब पे उनको साहित्य अकादमी मिला था। उसमें एक सड़क बनने की दास्तान है जो इधर बोमडिला से गुजरती है, और उस सड़क के बनने इतिहास में तो केवल ये दर्ज होगा कि वो सड़क कब से कब बनी, तेजपुर से वो सड़क भालुकपुंग होते हुए बोमडिला कब बनी और कौन लोग उसको बना रहे थे, लेकिन जो लोग उसमें काम करने आ रहे थे उनकी जिंदगी के बारे में लिख के ऐसे दोलजी थोंगची ने हमको इतिहास का वो सूत्र दिया, जिससे हम ये समझ सकें कि जो ट्राइब्स वहां रह रही थी आसपास, बहुत नजदीक थी, केवल उनके बीच में एक नदी या एक पहाड़ का फासला था, लेकिन उनके रीति रिवाज कितने अलग थे और उनके अपने तनाव कैसे हैं, उनका जो उनके बीच में जो संबंध है, प्रेम है, तनाव है, वो कैसे आता है जो इतिहास में दर्ज नहीं होगा। ऐसी बहुत सारी छोटी छोटी चीजें जो असल में बहुत महत्वपूर्ण है किसी भी समाज के लिए, उसके इतिहास के लिए, लेकिन वो इतिहास में दर्ज नहीं होती हैं, उनको साहित्य दर्ज करता है। इस लिहाज से मुझे ये काम बहुत महत्वपूर्ण लगता है, और बहुत बढ़िया बात यह है कि प्रोफेसर हितेंद्र पटेल की गति साहित्य और इतिहास दोनों में है। मैं आप लोगों को बताऊं कि उन्होंने दो हिंदी के बहुत अच्छे उपन्यास लिखे हैं, एक का नाम है हारिल और एक का नाम है चिरकुट। ये दोनों ही बहुत बढ़िया उपन्यास हैं, बहुत अच्छे प्रकाशनों से प्रकाशित हुए। तो हम एक ऐसे आदमी से आज रूबरू हैं जिसकी इतिहास और साहित्य दोनों में गति है, वो केवल इतिहासकार नहीं है, साहित्यकार भी है। मैं प्रोफेसर पटेल का एक परिचय पढ़ देता हूँ छोटा सा। प्रोजेक्ट का नाम है द पॉलिटिक्स ऑफ नेशनलिज्म एंड लिटरेरी इमेजिनेशन, चार हिंदी के रचनाकारों के उपन्यासों के बारे में है। प्रोफेसर पटेल रविंद्र भारती विश्वविद्यालय कलकत्ता के इतिहास विभाग में पढ़ाते हैं। उन्होंने जवाहरलाल नेहरू विश्वविद्यालय से PhD की है। उनके जो महत्वपूर्ण प्रकाशन है, कम्युनलिज्म एंड द इंटेलिजेंसिया इन बिहार 1870-1930, खुदीराम बोस रिवोल्यूशनरी एक्स्ट्राऑर्डिनरी, ये किताब छपी है। खुदीराम बोस एक अप्रतिम क्रांतिकारी के नाम से हिंदी में भी छपी है। भारत का पहला मुक्ति संघर्ष, और तीन भाषाओं में उनके लेख प्रकाशित हैं, 50 से अधिक लेख उनके हिंदी, बांग्ला और अंग्रेजी में, तीनों भाषाओं में उनकी गति है और उनके लेख तीनों भाषाओं में विभिन्न पत्र पत्रिकाओं में प्रकाशित हैं। हिंदी की पत्रिकाओं में और हिंदी के पाठकों के बीच में बहुत परिचित है, सुपरिचित है। मैं तो हिंदी का विद्यार्थी रहा हूँ और बहुत सारे हिंदी के लोग इनको जानते हैं और ये समझते हैं कि हिंदी के आदमी हैं, बाद में पता चलता है कि वो इतिहास के व्यक्ति हैं। मैं उन्हें आमंत्रित करता हूँ कि वे आए और अगले एक घंटे आपके हैं। सर
थैंक यू डॉक्टर अभिषेक यादव। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू ऑल माय फ्रेंड्स फॉर बीइंग हियर, एंड अनलेस आई कम टू दिस रूम आई डोंट रियली फील लाइक बीइंग इन IIS वेबिनार। आई डोंट लाइक दैट, आई मीन वंस यू स्टार्ट facing friends here, you feel motivated. And I am doubly motivated because Professor Pranjpe has given me the excuse to go into a subject on which I hardly get the opportunity to speak on. Why this demarcation of literature and history? I'm not interested in that at all. I am more interested in understanding the time, which historians have understood in a way, and political novelists have understood somewhat differently. And for me, this becomes an engaging question because I believe that historians have not done their duties properly. And let me be very blunt on that. And why I'm saying this, and there is a personal experience associated with that, why I started looking into it the way I am right now. In 2008, it was a centenary year of Khudiram Bose, and the then Minister of Education or HRD, whatever that be, was from Bengal, and he had given the diktat that there must be a biography on Khudiram Bose. And no, what is called a reputed historian was willing to take up that project. And I was contacted and I was given, because the person who was the in charge of that was a old friend of mine of JNU days. And he said that, please rescue us, write a book on Khudiram Bose. And I started. It was a surprise for me that why people are not interested in any biography of Khudiram Bose when the minister is interested. And when I started looking at the literature available on that, I found that there is no book available on Khudiram Bose. No book was available. One person has written in 1949, and that book was not available anywhere in any library. So it was a big challenge for me. Then I started looking into the Bengali sources, and I found that there are some biographies available in Bengali. And I consulted those biographies, and I tried to write a reasonable book in English. while working on that, I found out that there is some striking facts. There are certain striking facts which can be interest for any historian. For example, Khudiram Bose. Khudiram Bose is an icon, you all know. Khudiram Bose statue was installed in Muzaffarpur, and Indian Prime Minister was consulted for inauguration and all. He refused. Once Nehruji refused, Chief Minister also refused. And there was no eminent Congress leader available to be present in that occasion in independent India. So what could be the reason? And the statement of Nehru is quite striking. And the striking thing is that he said that these kind of revolutionaries, if be given that kind of prominence, that would not be good for us. And that came as a very, this was very surprising for me. And then more surprising was in store, that I found that not only Khudiram Bose, there was no book available on Indian revolutionary movement till 1960s. And I can quote R.C. Majumdar, and he had lamented in 60s that why we are forgetting Indian revolutionaries when we write history. And he said that let us write the history of Indian revolutionary. He's writing it probably 1966, 67 or 69, what that could be. Then I started thinking about it. And I found out that there is a reluctance on the part of eminent historians to talk about other kind of movements which can be associated with national movement. And there was a kind of inclination to bring into focus only one stream of national movement, and that is what is being highlighted in the writings of Indian national movement. Then I looked into it, and then I found out that 40s onwards, there was a conscious effort on the part of historians, whereby the historians have been instructed and historians have followed that Indian history writing should be done in a fashion which is more suitable for the kind of history the then government was interested in promoting. And I found large number of addresses, including those of Jawaharlal Nehru, Rajendra Prasad, and many others, who were advising that why we can't write the history of India, in which the biggest revolution of the world can be seen in a way in which we can be very proud of. 1920 onwards, there was a national movement and passive movement, non-violent movement, which is unique in the world. And therefore, a particular kind of history writing was promoted. Now, there is nothing wrong in that. I mean, the national movement was led by Gandhi, but that could not be considered the only stream of national movement. And any person who is interested, well-versed with the literature, would be able to agree with me that there are some other kind of streams which were available then. But what was more surprising for me was that historians' response to this kind of request or this kind of advice coming from the political quarters. And I can take you to 1947 Indian History Congress, which was attended by Chagla. And Chagla is giving advice to the historians to write that kind of history which can guide the politicians how to bring revolution in this country. So this was this kind of instruction. I'm using instruction only to highlight that thing. The politicians do not instruct, they advise, And it is the folly of the academicians that they take it as a diktat or the kind of instruction, and they follow it. Politicians say to bow and we lie down. So that is another story. So what is important there? That Muhammad Habib, let me read. This is Muhammad Habib, first president of Indian History Congress, and he is saying, from I'm quoting, at a time when in an atmosphere of inexpressible gloom, our country was lying helpless under the heel of the foreigner, without self-respect, without vision, and without hope, it pleased the Lord to send to us the greatest Indian teacher of all times. This is Gandhi. And under his divinely inspired guidance, we have, after a bloodless struggle of 30 years, liquidated peacefully and by mutual agreement, mark those words, mutual agreement, one of the most powerful empires the world has seen. Neither the foreign ruler nor his Indian underling has suffered anything in the process. This is the historian. And he's making these observations when Gandhi is alive. 1947, this is happening in December. Now, there are so many other passages, but I have to go to the literature. Go to literature, because Ranpiji has said that there is nothing of literature in this abstract. Everything, whatever I have understood, dealing with that kind of past, I have understood better in literature. And let me admit it, and I want to emphasize on this point, because literature as a form provides you that space where you can tell different types of things, even contradictory things, and that space is created in novel, and therefore you can talk favorably for even Muslim League, for Hindu Mahasabha and Congress in the same space. Whereas in history, and Indian history writing let me jump to that very important issue. The way Indian history has been written, this has followed march of history kind of understanding. Only those things are important which ultimately proved successful. In history, only those important issues become important, most important, which have ultimately succeeded. Literary space actually provides us other kind of spaces where you can actually talk about those movements, those efforts which have failed. And therefore, the stories coming in literature has a better space in which you can actually talk about the failed attempts, which it actually did not materialize. Now, getting back to my main story, which I would like to bring your attention on, and that is why I chose these novels. Many of you have read Mailachal, many of you have read Adha Gaon, Tamas, and many other novels. But I was interested in only those political novels, which are written by those writers who have taken up the entire period the way a historian can deal with. They are not going out of history. They are following the history, only they are bringing characters in such a way that various narratives, various kind of interpretations can figure in that national movement accounts. A person who is promoting Muslim League or associated with Muslim League, person who can be associated with Communist Party, they can also be part of that. To do justice, which is a very, very important thing whenever you deal with subject like national movement, I have chosen Yashpal, who represents not centrist position, but a left position. But people hardly makes any difference between centrist and leftist positions. And everything is moving towards right. Therefore, a leftist like Yashpal becomes centrist in some of the nations. But that is another thing. So Yashpal is represents the leftist stream. And quite, I focus on Yashpal in this presentation. Amritla Nagar is very close to what is what can be called Congress position with left leanings or socialist leanings. He was close to Nehru. He was close to Gandhi also. But to be fair with his approach, he is trying to be just to all sides. And therefore, he was critical to Gandhian movement in spite of being reverential towards Gandhi as a person. Then Bhagwati Chand Varma. I think there are eminent, I mean, literary persons are available here. Let me say that Bhagwati Chand Varma has not been properly understood. Bhagwati Chand Varma has been part of, it represents the space which can be called center and rightist space. I mean, he is very soft to Jansang, and he is not very, very sensitive about issues on which people are very reluctant to speak on. He is very harsh on Gandhi at times, very, very harsh on Nehru. And still, you will find that he is not doing injustice to any side. And that is why Bhagwati Chand Varma and all these writers have covered this period, which is my period for this history, 1920 to 1960. Bhagwati Chand Varma, then Amritlal Nagar, Bhagwati Chand Varma, and then most important in my study and most challenging also, Guru Dutt. People laugh at me. I remember when I presented in the last presentation, everybody was in a way surprised. That person who is chairing the session was very surprised. And he said that you are going to change your position once you start talking about Yashpal. Because he's branded as a communal. And therefore, how can a communal man can write about the history of modern India? He was close to what is called RSS. He was close to Hindu Mahasabha. And he was close to what is called right space. So Guru Dutt, bringing Guru Dutt into it is very surprising. And let me explain why I brought in Guru Dutt. Guru Dutt is probably the most challenging writer for some reasons. I cannot go into details, but there are two, three points which are to be kept in mind. First of all, he is the only writer, and perhaps some references can be made to Chatur Sen. But Chatur Sen and Guru Dutt are two writers who actually talked about the anguish of rightist people who were also associated with national movement. They also sacrificed. Some of them were associated with the revolutionary movement. They were Savarkarite, and they were ready to sacrifice. And still, they were not finding space in the national movement. They were branded as communal. And therefore, to get to know about the story from their side, he is a very important man. And he's the man who had seen it all. And he, more importantly, he wrote books when the movement was going on. His first book came in early 40s. And he is a man who has not seen the partition, and he is anticipating that it will lead to partition. How could somebody write in 1943 that this kind of process will ultimately lead to partition on communal grounds? Let us give some credit to that man. Even if I believe that some of the things which can be questioned, because he actually told the story from a point of view where from religion becomes the core, the most important theme around which a nation can be built. So Gurudatta's story has to be brought in. And I'm amazed by the kind of frankness which are available there. And he has also used historical sources. Particularly, I would mention that when Gandhi is finding himself in a very uncomfortable position in 40s, many of us do not realize that Gandhi had become somewhat very problematic for even what is called Gandhian inclusive nationalist leadership. He has made life miserable for them. He's saying something which is not making people comfortable. And his presence was uncomfortable for Congress even. And when he died, I think, let me say this, the most relieved people were the people who had been in power at that time. They loved him, they worshipped him, but still, the kind of presence and the kind of questions Gandhi was raising made the rulers, the then rulers, very uncomfortable. And this is the problem. Somebody who has dealt with Gandhi in that situation can really tell us what kind of existence Gandhi had in 40s, and why Gandhi was in such an uncomfortable situation is a question about which historians have been very reluctant to talk about. Makarand Paranjpe ji has done a book on that, and he has come up with some kind of understanding of why Gandhi found himself in that position. But he does not take any position. He simply says that it is Gandhi who is sacrificing his life in the yajna and ends there. And this position is, I find it very uncomfortable, because he's in fact he's offering his body and his life for yajna. This is very abstract kind of position. Either you say that Gandhi was, this is, Paranjpe ji is very categorical on that. The historians are not very categorical, and they are not acknowledging certain historical facts. But the point is that it has to be admitted that Gandhi had become politically irrelevant in 1940s. He had his following among the people, but politically he has become irrelevant, out of tune. I keep saying for many years now, why Gandhi became so out of tune with political realities? That is a question about which historians have reasons to be silent on, or at least they are not saying those things categorically. But luckily, literatures have been quite open about it. If you read Maila Achal, and many of you have read Maila Achal, you would find that not only Gandhi was ineffective in a way, clueless in another way, all Gandhians have found themselves in a very difficult situation. The people who have been in power and who are coming to power are the same people who had been collaborators of colonial period. And this is something about which we are not ready to listen and even talk about. Let me be very, very, very categorical on two points. One thing I should say for convenience, that in India, there were workers, there were peasants, there were monks, and the collaborators. Indian history can be written also like that. Peasants, workers, monks, and collaborators. And collaborators include capitalists. Collaborators include what we call a middle class. Collaborators include police, army men. Now, army and police is some. These are the two groups about which we have to be little more. I mean, we should understand their position. From 1900 onwards, by the turn of the century, at least 1905 onwards, if not earlier, there were people who anticipated, who thought that there can be a revolution. There can be a revolution which could involve army people, and through force, we can bring revolution in India. I have written very extensively on that. 1905 onwards, I'm not going into that details. You can go on to the story of Bagha Jatin, 1914-15. Aurobindo, Bagha Jatin, Rashbihari Bose. These people were doing things, trying to start a revolution in India. And they were always trying to bring army into it. And they believed that without army's involvement, revolution cannot be possible. And so 1918-19 onwards, there was a situation which was favorable for a revolution. Many people say and keep saying that these people were adventurous people. They were revolutionaries, very brave. They could sacrifice their lives, but they were not realistic enough. And people believe that these people should be appreciated for nationalism and their love for country, but they were not politically informed people, and they did not have real understanding of the political situation. They were not political people, they were merely revolutionaries. Okay? But now literature has come up, large number of books have been written, and it is widely believed that it is not something which they were doing simply to kill some English people, and they were simply out for some kind of adventure. No, they were thinking people. They were planning things, and they were aware that unless we get some outside support, unless we get arms from outside, unless we put some pressure on in British, Britishers are not going to go out of India. They should be pushed out. And for that, there were people who were engaged in. In this context, Gandhi's coming and going out of MN Roy coincide at that point. In 1915, Gandhi comes and MN Roy is moving out to bring arms. So these two gentlemen can be compared, and no historian is ready to make that comparison. And these people are not trying to understand that MN Roy was not merely a terrorist. He was a thinking man, and he had a planning of revolution. He wanted to bring revolution in India. He was the disciple of Bagha Jatin. And remember, even Bhagat Singh was a follower of Bagha Jatin. If you think about the efforts of Viren Chattopadhyay and others, if you link that story to Barkatullah's story, if you link the story of Gadar Party, and if you link that with Rashbihari Bose, and then you link it to MN Roy, you have a continuity of those kind of efforts, and those efforts are actually trying to bring revolution in India. They were not terrorists, but terrorists, they are called. And even after that, what happens? There is a story, I mean, you can relate it to the formation of Hindustan Republic Army. You can bring in Bismil, you can bring in Azad, you can bring in Yashpal and many others. So this is a story of revolutionaries, not terrorists, is a political story. But let me go back to the principal objection, I would not say, principal limitation of my approach to it, is that I'm not bringing literature into it. How can we bring literature into it? And that can be done very judiciously if we bring in Yashpal. Who was Yashpal? Yashpal was born in 1903 in Himachal Pradesh. What is the place name? District of Kangra. Kangra. He was born here. He studied in Arya Samaj school from 7 to 14. And then he moved to Lahore. And in Lahore, he studied with others, which included Bhagat Singh, Bhagwati Chand, and others. Bhagat Singh and Yashpal were friends, and they placed to serve the nation together. Incidentally, the headmaster was Guru Dutt, the famous communal writer. Headmaster was Guru Dutt. So stories are getting very close. So this is Lahore. And these people were planning revolution. They are doing things. Yashpal, anyway, you might know that he was involved in number of activities, including an effort to blow the train of Lord Irwin. And it almost succeeded. It almost succeeded. That man who did this was very important man in the group in which Azad was the leader. Now, this man had some differences with leadership and his other members. And that difference is because he thought that revolution cannot be possible by these kind of revolutionary acts. We must get into Congress, which is a popular organization. We must try to influence the Congress so that we can have a kind of political voice in the politics of India, and Congress should be influenced. And this is the line which M.N. Roy is also taking once he comes back from Russia. Disillusioned in a way, in fact, he was out of favor by 1930. Before that, he had tried to do many things. I do not have the time to go into that. So this position of Yashpal is very interesting. Now he is trying to influence Congress, and he wants to influence people in such a way that the revolutionary project should go on with Congress. And at that point, he had differences with his colleagues. And there was another reason. The reason was that he was involved with a girl, Prakashvati Kapoor, and they wanted to marry, they wanted to live together, and the revolutionary leadership was not willing to allow that space in that revolutionary organization. He had to leave. There are evidences that Azad ordered his killing, but somehow he managed to survive because he had also good friends in the organization, and he survived. Ultimately, what happened, whether Chandrasekhar Azad forgave him or not, is something people are disputing. There are controversy over it. I would like to bring into notice one address which was delivered here in IIAS by Sanjeev Tanyal, in which he has categorically said that Yashpal was a collaborator and he was a spy and he worked for British intelligence service and he provided all the necessary information. In fact, he also hinted that Chandrasekhar Azad was identified by the police because of the evidence, because of the clue provided by Yashpal. I was a bit surprised by that. So I looked into it and then I found out that there are two documents which have been produced by a dubious character, Dharmendra Gaur, that he said that these two evidences are from archives of Uttar Pradesh. And on that basis, it was conclusively proved that Yashpal was a traitor he was responsible for the death of Azad, and he collaborated with British. So far, it can be true. I mean, any historian should be open to all kind of evidences, and he should be willing to improvise, modify his opinion. But so far, there is no conclusive evidence that Yashpal was like that. And therefore, Yashpal should be given a fair trial. Simply on the basis of the fact that he was put in Naini jail after the encounter with the police, and some other kind of evidences are available, and his case was pleaded by Shyam Kumari Nehru. Therefore, he is to be seen as somebody who was the beneficiary of Nehruvian association and all that is to be challenged. And I think that Yashpal should be given a fair hearing. Now, I have other kind of evidences also, but I would like to bring in more literature into it. Now, Yashpal had written novels. One is Dada Comrade. You must read that book. It is simple. This is an account which gives you real characters. On the one hand, Harish, which is Yashpal, and on the other hand, we have Azad. And there is an interesting kind of dialogue in between these two people. So this dialogue between Azad and Yashpal, which is coming in this novel, is something which is to be seen and studied. Second book is Deshadrohi. And remember, these books are written in 1900, around 1940, 41, 42, 43. This is in this period, these books are being written. Deshadrohi. Deshadrohi is a fantastic story in which you can go into all kinds of stories in which you all are familiar with, that how Indians went to Tashkent, to Moscow, tried to bring a communist revolution and all kinds of stories. This very interestingly written, Deshadrohi. But people, even Hindi critics, have been unfair to Yashpal, and they did not see these kind of political stories in a fair manner. They simply thought that this is a story written from Yashpal's side. There is history in that. And then he wrote a book in 50s and 56 or 58, which is a classic, which is you all have heard about. Jhootha Sach 1 and Jhootha Sach 2, and then on which I wanted to present, mainly focus on Meri Teri Uski Baat, which was written in 1973. What is the time span? He has written, Yashpal has written in Meri Teri Uski Baat, this political story of the period between 1919 to 1947. And this book has not been given that much importance, because here he is directly hitting the political elites. How Subhash Chandra Bose was sidelined, how Bidhan Chandra Rai and Congress leaders were instrumental in that. And that is the moment when Subhash Chandra Bose was not supported by socialists. And what was going on at the grassroots level. And he has argued in that book that there were three kind of objections. There were three streams which were objecting all through the period, what is called Gandhian movement. They were not happy with Gandhi. First and foremost was aggressive congressmen, militant congressmen. They were not happy with Congress. They were not happy with Gandhi's withdrawal in 1922. Chauri Chaura. Subhash Kushwaha has written on it, and many others have written, and in fact, you will not find anybody, including Jawaharlal Nehru and Motilal Nehru, who is supportive of this kind of withdrawal after 1922 February. Why Gandhi did that? That is a story. Now, thereafter, in fact, in my abstract, I have mentioned that I would like to bring into your notice three major problematics. One is why Gandhi failed to bring Hindus and Muslims together, first. Second, how Congress actually was not ready to listen to Gandhi at one point of time. And then I also have brought in some other issues, but I will not have the time to go into that. But addressing these issues from novelist point of view, Yashpal's story is interesting, that he is giving space to all sides. He's saying that Gandhi was a great man. Gandhi brought people in a way in politics, and he admits that. But he says that this is the thing Gandhi did, and for that he can be credited. And I'm not saying that it is Gandhi and Jugal. It is Yashpal who is saying that this is Gandhi and Jugal, because people rallied behind Gandhi. Therefore, it should be called Gandhian Age. But Gandhian Age ends in 1939-40. Thereafter, another age begins. We have not periodized that period, whether it was Gandhian, whether it was Nehru. It was a period during which it was decided that it will not be Gandhian anymore. So the beginning of Nehruvian period and the end of Gandhian period gives us a kind of 7-8 years time, during which it was not Gandhian period, but maintained that it was a Gandhian period. This is the period about which historians do not really talk about. You will find that Subhas Bose goes out and Quit India movement begins. In history book, my friend El Sahab is there. In history book, this is taught like that. But Subhas Bose was ousted unfairly in 1939. Unfairly. And these details are there in Yashpal. How people were creating all sorts of nuisance, all kind of things there in the Congress session. It is written by Bhagwatishan Verma also. And remember, these people were there in the pandal when this was going on. They were not writing on the basis of records. These people were present in the pandal when these kind of things were done. So if we take these novelists, not merely as novelists, but also as first-hand account providers, then you should at least talk about the evidences they have produced in the form of literature as real evidences. Because these people were present in that session itself. Even in Congress session, which actually started this Quit India movement. He says, Yashpal says, and he says this is, he tells this story in a fascinating manner. He creates a character who is a Gandhian. Usha Seth, she's a Gandhian. The main protagonist of the novel is a Gandhian. Had immense faith in Gandhi. But later on, when these kind of experiences take place, and what happens? They become critical of Gandhi. And they became socialists. Some of them became communists. Some of them became Royist, M.N. Roy. People forget that M.N. Roy was very much active all through. After 1930, he was in jail. And after 1936-38, he was also in the process. In the political process. So M.N. Roy's criticism and all kind of political activism was going on. This story I don't find in history books, but I find in मेरी तेरी उसकी बात, रीड दैट बुक, दिस वॉल्यूमिनस बुक, एंड एवरीथिंग एंड एवरीथिंग इज वेल डॉक्यूमेंटेड. आई डिडंट फाइंड एनी रेफरेंस टू हिस्टोरिकल इवेंट व्हिच आई कैन एज अ हिस्टोरियन आई कैन रेज डाउट ऑन. एवरी डेट इज चेक्ड, एवरीथिंग इज डिटेल्ड इन सच ए मैनर दैट यू कैनॉट टेक इट एज समथिंग विच कम्स फ्रॉम द इमेजिनेशन ऑफ द राइटर. He says that I'm telling this story from this point of view, and this is my view. That is perfectly all right. Because if you want to understand Yashpal, read his Postmortem of Gandhism. Mortem of Now, that book came out in 1941, remember? He wrote it in 1941. And if you read that book, you will find why Yashpal was a thinker. And why I'm claiming that Yashpal was a thinker. In 1941, he's making those kind of observations which ultimately proved him right. Gandhi was unable to keep Hindus and Muslims together. And why he could not do this can be understood by carefully reading what M.N. Roy had written in 1922-23. Nobody reads M.N. Roy anymore. But he said that ultimately this man is not going to be successful. He will not be able to do that because he is relying on the conservative section of Muslim community. He is not going with the progressive element of Muslim community. I mean, Roy is saying this, and somehow I found, and this is my strong impression that Yashpal was getting very close to M. N. Roy's position when he writes about the period 1942. This Usha Seth is the person who is instrumental in rebellion in two cities. One is Banaras and other is Lucknow. And she is leading the movement. And she then moves on to Balia. We all know that Balia was liberated for a week or so. And she was leading that movement. If you read the account, you will find that we are reading a historical account of that period. But ultimately what happens, this is Yashpal. He says that the movement was started. People were given all kind of impressions that six commandments came, that people, you can go out and destroy the public buildings, do everything possible to destroy the British rule. But what was the blueprint? What will happen when the army will come? When the army will come, what the people will do? This was not given. This clue was not given to the people. And therefore, when the army came and they mercilessly beaten people, killed people, burned people, raped people. What kind of rape incidents have been described, you know? Upper caste people, women were raped by lower caste people of that same village on gunpoint, and the Britishers were doing it. These things are happening in Balia. This very description is there in that book, Meri Teri Uski Baat. So these things, who is responsible for that? This question is raised by a character of Yashpal. Who is responsible for this? She says that the people have suffered because wrong commandments were given and people were not taking the responsibility for these kind of actions. People said, go and destroy. Do whatever you like. Karo ya maro, do or die. And then these congressmen went inside the jail comfortably, and after some time, the statement comes from Gandhi that he condemns these acts. All congressmen believe that this kind of violence was not, they had called. This violence they condemn. But after 46, this is Yashpal. He says that नेहरू वॉज द फर्स्ट पर्सन टू टेक द क्रेडिट ऑफ 1942. दिस इज अनएथिकल. दिस इज यशपाल. He says that it's unethical to take credit of 1942 when you have condemned those acts and without giving them the adequate kind of understanding of what this movement could lead to, what can happen. So people suffered, and the people who managed to take some credit out of it became the rulers. This is Yashpal. And he also brought in some other very related issues. He says that congressmen did not suffer, and there was a difference between the sufferings of the Congress and the revolutionaries. If you put your life on trial, you are a revolutionary, because you can be killed, you can be executed, you can be sent at least to Andaman. But congressmen, they were to put in jail for 6 months, 3 months, 8 months, 2 years, 3 years, but you are not going to die. How many congressmen have died during the shootout? No. Most of the people who died were common people. Most of the revolutionaries who sacrificed their lives were common people. So he distinguished between the Congress people and revolutionaries and common people. The common people suffered, revolutionaries made sacrifices, and all the credits were appropriated by people who had the art of managing things in such a way that the power went into their hands. When I'm saying this, actually, you can really think how Mailachal's story comes into the frame. The people who had been clever enough, the collaborators, they took the power. They had to shift side from this side to that side, and therefore the new ruling authority, ruling dispensation, was in their command. So the same rule continues. There was no revolution as such. Revolution was not there, but freedom movement we have got. I mean, freedom we have got. Now I take you to another novel, and that I think that should be my last point. The Jhootha Sach. Jhootha Sach has two volumes, very voluminous book. Many of you might have read it. First book is titled Watan or Desh. Watan or Desh. What is the difference between Watan and Desh? He says that people lived in their Watan. People lived in Lahore under the impression that they will be taken care of by the leadership, the leaders. But the leaders were unable to decide where Lahore would ultimately go. Even on 11th of August, people did not know whether Lahore would be in Pakistan or in India. And they are struggling. They are not getting any real impression, any idea whether they will remain in Pakistan or India. Gurudat has written on it. He says that from March to August, people are suffering. In Lahore, Hindus are suffering. In Jalandhar, Muslims are suffering. And they are not given the real idea whether Jalandhar would be in India or Lahore would be in Pakistan. No, they did not know. And therefore, in that process, these people died. They say that why should we leave our Watan? This is my Watan. We have created this. Our ancestors have lived in this Watan. We are not going to anywhere. We will sacrifice our lives. But the politicians are not there to guide them to take the responsibility. The Watan Paras were sufferers, common people were sufferers, and those people who put the lines there, they were politicians, they were not people. So Desh was being built, Desh was being created, and people who were clinging to their Watan, they were suffering. Who is going to take the responsibility for that? Obviously the political class. And that is why he's very, very categorical on that point, that political class should take the responsibility for that. In Jhootha Sach, there is one incident where the protagonist of the Jhootha Sach is in Nainital. And he is describing that in very details, that these people who are coolies, who are Purabiyas, people from Uttar Pradesh, they are dancing. They are jumping that they have got independence. But next morning, they will have to work as porters, coolies. They don't understand that their independence has not come. It is the independence of the elites, the collaborators, which has arrived in 1946, 1947. Not the people's revolution has not taken place. Therefore, he's very, very categorical on that. Now, what happened after that? So-called collaborator of Nehru, collaborator of CID of British Yashpal. In 1956, he wrote that, and there was Sahitya Academy Award to be given. Sahitya Academy Award is to be given, and the choice fell into two books. One was written by Yashpal, Jhoota Sach, and other was Bhagwati Chand Verma, Bhule Visre Chitra. And judges were of the opinion that Jhoota Sach is a classic, so Jhoota Sach should be given the Sahitya Academy Award. But somebody, a very eminent literary person, a Nehruite, he made it a point that as because he was very critical of Gandhi, I mean Nehru, in that Jhoota Sach, he cannot be given Sahitya Academy Award. Now, he was not given Sahitya Academy Award for this book. Then, in the last days, weeks before he died in 1976, as a compensation, he was given a Sahitya Academy Award for Meri Teri Uski Baat. Now, you can say that it is possible that somehow this establishment has made amends, I mean, some kind of compensation was done. I mean, no, it was not that. There was one very powerful man, P.N. Haxar. He has written a letter in 1969 to Indira Gandhi. You can see that, I mean, these references are there in my write-up. It's my write-up is about 600 to 700 pages, more than that. So I have traveled to many directions, and most of the things which I have picked up, I have picked up from literature. A conscious effort I have made to put aside my historian side, historian self, from the project, and let the literature speak to its audience. And I found out that these pieces give us real stuff, where they are not very, very, very considerate about political establishment, who are the leaders. They are very critical of Gandhi. They are very critical of Nehru. They are very critical of even Subhas at times. They are writing the stories of people and people's sufferings. For them, 1947, independence is not that important. For them, the suffering of the people, and that is very important. And therefore, in Jhoota Sach Part 2, when he talks about Desh Ka Bhavishya, future of India, he categorically mentions how this new ruling class is the continuation of the ruling class of British period. I cannot resist my temptation of bringing Gurudat once again. He says that we have all, he's a revolutionary, the protagonist. He says that we have all along fought against the police officer. These people have troubled us, they have killed us, they have done all kind of injustices to us. They have exploited everything. But suddenly independence is coming, and that police officer is raising the tricolor flag, and he's celebrating the independence. What is it? All this about. We have fought for it, we have sacrificed, and the people who are celebrating are the people who had been torturing us, and he given us all. So this voice is coming in all these writers' account, that the people who had been powerful earlier, they remain powerful even after independence. Therefore, ye azadi jhoota hai was said with some conviction at one point of time. But let me qualify my statement, and therefore I should bring Amritlal Nagar also. And Amritlal Nagar is important for two reasons. He has written a book, Pidhiya, Generations, in which he talks about a shift within that middle class space, which I have called collaborator. When I said collaborator, I was just provoked by some kind of observations. Otherwise, I would have made it a very different kind of presentation. Now, the thing is that he says that they started as collaborators. But at one point of time, people of the same family, which had been collaborated during 1857 and thereafter, they had become critical of British rule. And how this transition comes and how this transition takes place is very, very important in his literature. His grandfather is a sir, knighthood, I mean, the British's loyalist. And his grandson is facing the police in 1942. He died in a police encounter while protesting for August movement. The same middle class, which had been collaborator, becomes agitator in 1942. And the fascinating story of three generations, which has been which has been narrated in Karwat. Karwat is a major novel. Amrita Vish, Boond Aur Samudra, and Generations, four of novels. These four novels actually give us this entire historical time to tell us how middle class has also drifted from British. And they became, from collaborator to a nationalist. And in that process, and this is where he becomes very important, but they always remained conscious that they do not represent Bharatvarsh. They do not represent Bharatvarsh. They are in the process. They are fighting against the British, but they are not real Bharat. Real Bharat lives in the Gali Mohallas and villages. And this is where Boond and Samudra becomes such a classic book, where real Bharat Mata lives in the kasbas, in villages, and the common people with whom the middle class representative of that novel is unable to coordinate. He wants to go to those people to understand what Bharat Mata says. This is the story of Boond and Samudra. So these people were experimenting. These people are trying to deal with the complex realities of Indian society, its protests, its sufferings. And therefore, the time of that period, the agonizing details of sufferings and all kinds of things, including the movement, including all kinds of aspirations, and all those things are dealt with these political novelists in a very nuanced manner. And I think in this context, if somebody has the time or the conviction that there should not be any real demarcation between history and literature, as if history tells the story or the facts, no. Indian society cannot, the story of Indian society cannot be told merely through facts. We need kathas also, gathas also, and what Professor Paranjpe has in a moment said, wisdom, third eye, wisdom. This wisdom is very important. And also I would like to bring historian Tony Jute. He says that there is something which can be intuitively understood whether the person who is saying this is correct or not. Tony Jute says that if a story is being told, even if by historian following the historical method, if you feel that the story is not correct, you can say that no, this is not correct. A.G.P. Taylor has written on the basis of historical sources following historical methodology to tell that Hitler was not responsible for the Second World War. So Trevor Roper and Tony Jute, these are the historians who said that whatever be your explanations, whatever way you have said it, but this is not true. This is not true. So therefore, when you read these novels, when you read Mailachal, when you read Satinath Bhaduri, when you read Amritlal Nagar, when you read Yashpal, when you read Bhagwatijan Verma, you will feel that these people are saying what was true. And the things which have been taught to us through historical texts may have followed the historical method, but it rings untrue. And obviously, let me include, I mean, conclude that these are very difficult questions and a very complex kind of issues. And these problematics cannot be resolved. And that is why I say that problematics are like those questions. Aapne wo katha suni hogi, Vikram aur Vetal ki. You solve the problem, and again, Vetal is on the dial. Therefore, so I think that I should be grateful to IIS and my chairpersons. First chairperson was Professor M.P. Singh, then Professor Pradhan, and now Dr. Yadav. These three gentlemen have chaired my sessions. I'm grateful to the selection committee for giving me the opportunity to work on it. I have been struggling to convince my historians' friends to please listen to these literatures. They are saying something very, very important. We have failed to understand the time and its complexity. These people can help us to get a better view. And once I tried to be a fellow here, I was rejected because that committee was headed by a historian. Next time, a literature was chairing the committee and a philosopher was listening very patiently and favorably. Therefore, I got the chance. So I should thank the selection committee also for giving me two valuable years where I could actually get into it and raise some questions, even if I'm unable to say that I have resolved this issue, because fir se Vital dal pe. Thank you very much, Padmini.
बहुत ही ऊर्जावान और बहुत ही शानदार इस प्रेजेंटेशन के लिए मैं प्रोफेसर नितिन पटेल को बधाई देता हूं और शुभकामना देता हूं। एक बात जो मेरे मन में आपको सुनते हुए बार बार आ रही थी वो ये कि ये बात सच साबित हो गई कि यशपाल ने सब बदल दिया। यशपाल आए और उन्होंने सारा एक डिस्कोर्स चला आ रहा है उसको पलट के रख दिया। यशपाल को पढ़ें तो तब पता चलता है कि साहित्य में कितना गहरा इतिहास बोध है। हम लोग ये समझते हैं कि कोई उपन्यास, कोई कविता, कोई कहानी लिखी गई है तो बस उसमें अलंकार और कुछ खोज लें और उससे काम चल जाए, छंद खोज लें। यशपाल के सारे उपन्यास और उनकी रचनाएं कितने गहरे इतिहास बोध है उनमें, ये आपने बहुत अच्छे से इसको बताया। और भारतीय इतिहास लेखन में जिन धाराओं को छोड़ दिया गया है और क्यों छोड़ दिया गया है, इसके बारे में भी बहुत अच्छा विश्लेषण आपने किया। मैं अब चाहता हूं कि